Morning to you. Thank you and all the best for the year, by the way, Doctor. It is always very, very sad while we're all talking about how well the matriculants have done. You look at the front pages of the papers, matrics jumping up and down with joy. There is the other side of matriculants who don't pass as well. Off the bat, what sort of advice do you give to someone who's had to deal with that now?
No, it's huge because the expectation of getting through and going into the big world is huge, and then you don't pass, and there's a huge increase of suicide, and the suicide lines, the helplines in South Africa, report that their lines have been inundated with calls from matric pupils during this time after having failed. So it's huge, and the parents must be on the lookout for certain signs of depression, you know, change in sleep pattern, drug abuse, change in eating patterns, picking up of weight, of losing of weight, not getting out of bed, signs of or talks of suicide, suicidal letters, anything to that extent that indicates that this pupil is out of their depth and they need to be sent for professional help.
I was reading yesterday, I thought this was quite interesting. It's not just perhaps the matriculants who have failed, and a lot of comments saying it's not the end of the world, you can move on, but also matriculants who have very high standards for themselves. Even perhaps wanting 7 distinctions, 8 distinctions, not reaching that can be as much of a problem for them as pupils who fail.
Hugely. The failed expectations are one of the worst things. I, in my own practice, worked with a matriculant who went on to university and found the jump from university standards to, from school standards to university standards, just too huge to cope with, and suffered with huge anxiety to the point of being suicidal and dropping out of the course and having to restart another year down the line. And we managed to pull her through the year, but it's huge, the amount of anxiety, the expectations, what pupils and parents put on themselves to go into the world. Now, we're in a very competitive world, and if you're not a top achiever, you battle to get into programs like actuary science, like medicine, CA, all of the sort of the programs, dentistry. And it's really hard to push, and in South Africa with its racial inequalities of the past and trying to redress that, a lot of children that has done very well from the previously advantaged groups will not get into those programs. So it's even harder for them to in a way, to get
to get results and succeed as well. When it comes to now the big question, I remember this when I was at varsity, I'm not sure it was the same for you, this gap year. I mean, is it a good idea if someone has got, for example, good marks, they can go to varsity or any post-school education facility, should they take a gap year? What's your feeling on this?
Gareth, the jury is out on that question, and it really depends from person to person, so it's really hard to give a blanket answer on that. Sometimes if a person is very immature still, if they're very unsure about what they want to do, that gap year is a very good year because you can go and you can perhaps travel the world, you can go and work as an intern type situation in an organization that you're keen on joining. If you want to become a psychologist, you can work for a hospice or something like that, or a childcare institution, or whatever. If a journalist, you can probably come to you guys and ask for something like that. There's some way of getting some feel of what you want to do into the future. So it can be very good. I have, however, seen that gap years where pupils just take a year, learners just take a year off and do nothing and then stay off until they're 30 one day and they've had a huge 12-year-old gap year and still not gone back to university.
Doctor, just as a final question, I don't mean to be rude to interrupt. If someone is watching at the moment, not just perhaps parents, but friends of a matric student, just briefly, if you could go through those warning signs again, any changes in behavior, what are the key warning signs where they need to get up and go and look for help?
The key warning signs are really severe withdrawal if the child doesn't come out, or severe change of personality. So if they've been very quiet, suddenly they become drinkers and they're out there and they smoke and they do drugs and whatever, and it's not part of their personality. So anything that's different to what a person has behaved before, not getting out of bed in the mornings, which is very an adolescent trait, but I mean, if they do it
sleeping
time
late
after
is
time,
one thing, not getting up is something else.
Not getting up at all is something else. Weight changes, huge weight loss, huge weight gain is a signal. Talk of hopelessness, of not knowing what to do with their lives, of not sure where to go. Suicidal talk is always serious. Ooh. You know, people who commit suicide often give notice beforehand. It could be written, could be something they say. So for parents to be on the lookout for that and to reach out to mental health facilities.
Doctor, huge pleasure. Thank you very much for coming in this morning. Clinical psychologist Dr. Ian Opperman giving some advice to parents and friends as well for matriculants who might not be coping quite as well with their results as you might think. If you think there's a concern at all, best is to take them for some advice as quickly as you can. These are your headline stories.